back. My name is Dawn, and this is Living a Word-Filled Life. And once upon a time, there was a guy who appointed himself king. Even though he wasn't the rightful king, he appointed himself king. Had the whole celebration, did all the things, and went on to pretend that he was the rightful king. So, I'm going to start this story with a little bit of background. First of all, the story is a true story, and it's from the Bible. And King David, who had lived a full life, was about to pass away. And he was on his deathbed, and that's kind of where the story picks up. So I want to share this with you. We're going to start in 1 Kings. We're going to read 1 Kings chapter 1, verses 5 through 8. Now Adonijah, whose mother was Haggith, put himself forward and said, "I will be king." So he got chariots and horses ready, with 50 men to run ahead of him. His father had never interfered with him by asking, "Why do you behave as you do?" He was also very handsome and was born next after Absalom. Adonijah conferred with Joab, son of Zeruiah, and with Abiathar, the priest, and they gave him their support. But Zadok, the priest, Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, Nathan, the prophet, Shimei, and Reaiah, and David's special guard, did not join Adonijah. So he gathered his team of people together, and he gathered his team based on who he knew would side with him. So the other people who knew the truth, he didn't even mention them. He didn't even let them know what was going on. Okay, we're going to pick up now. We're going to read verses 9 through 10. Adonijah then sacrificed sheep, cattle, fattened calves at the stone of Reholath, near Enrogel. He invited all his brothers, the king's sons, all the men of Judah who were royal officials, but he did not invite Nathan, the prophet of Benaiah, or the special guard, or his brother Solomon. So that was pretty interesting, where he wanted to create a transfer of kingship, but he didn't invite the prophets, the priest, and the brother, the one brother who knew the truth, who knew that what he was doing wasn't right. So he invited everybody again, but them. All right, we're going to pick up. We're going to read verses 11 through 23. Then Nathan asked Bathsheba, Solomon's mother, "Have you not heard that Adonijah, the son of Haggith, has become king without our Lord David knowing it? Now then, let me advise you on how you can save your own life and the life of your son Solomon. Go into King David and say to him, 'My lord the king, did you not swear to me, your servant, surely Solomon, your son, shall be king after me, and he will sit on my throne? Why then has Adonijah become king? While you are still there talking to the king, I will come in and confirm what you have said.'" So that was their plan. So Bathsheba went to see the aged king in his room where the Shunammite was attending him. Bathsheba bowed low and knelt before the king. "What is it you want?" the king said. She said to him, "My lord, yourself swore to me, your servant, by the Lord your God, Solomon your son shall be king after me, and he will sit on my throne. But now Adonijah has become king, and you, my lord the king, do not know about it. He has sacrificed great numbers of cattle, fattened calves, and sheep, and has invited all the king's sons, Abiathar the priest, and Joab the commander of the army. But he has not invited Solomon, your servant. My lord, the king, the eyes of all of Israel are on you to learn from you who will sit on the throne of my lord, the king, after him. Otherwise, as soon as my lord, the king, is laid to rest with his fathers, I and my son Solomon will be treated as criminals. While she was still speaking with the king, Nathan the prophet arrived, and they told the king, Nathan the prophet is here. So he went before the king and bowed with his face to the ground. So at this point, all who knew the truth are now gathering around King David. So let's see what happens. This is kind of exciting. Okay, verse 24 through 27. Nathan said, have you, my lord the king, declared that Adonijah should be king after you and that he will sit on your throne? Today he has gone down and sacrificed great numbers of cattle, fattened calves, and sheep. He has invited all the king's sons, the commanders of the army, and Abiathar the priest. Right now, they are eating and drinking with him and saying, long live King Adonijah. But me, your servant, and Zadok the priest, and Benaiah the son of Jehoiada, and your servant Solomon, he did not invite. Go figure. Is this something my lord the king has done without letting his servants know who should sit on the throne of my lord the king after him? So Adonijah was going through all the tradition of becoming a king. He had his little party. He had his little celebration where they swore him in as king and all his little peeps were there. And it was all, you know, being taken in like, okay, I am now the king. Woohoo! And he starts acting like he's the king, even though he is not the rightful king. So all his little peeps are going along with him because they think, okay, this is real. He's the king. All right. So here we go. Verse 28 through 37. Then King David said, call in Bathsheba. So she came into the king's presence and stood before him. The king then took an oath, as surely as the Lord lives, who has delivered me out of every trouble, I will surely carry out today what I swore to you by the Lord, the God of Israel. Solomon, your son, shall be king after me, and he will sit on my throne in my place. Then Bathsheba bowed low with her face to the ground and kneeling before the king said, may the Lord King David live forever. King David said, call in Zadok the priest, Nathan the prophet, Benaiah the son of Jehoiada. When they came before the king, he said to them, take your Lord's servants with you and set Solomon, my son, on my own mule and take him down to Gihon. There have Zadok the priest and Nathan the prophet anoint him over Israel. Blow the trumpet and shout, long live King Solomon. Then you are to go up with him, and he is to come in and sit on my throne and reign in my place. I have appointed him ruler over Israel and Judah. Benaiah the son of Jehoiada answered the king, amen. May the Lord, the God of my Lord, the king, so declare it. As the Lord was with my Lord the king, so may he be with Solomon to make his throne even greater than the throne of my Lord King David. So now the rightful king was anointed and named. But there's the other king. So there's two kings right now. How can that be? Well, let me tell you how that can be. One is legitimate and one is illegitimate. One is the rightful king and one is not the rightful king. Keep reading. Verse 38 through 40. So Zadok the priest, Nathan the prophet, Benaiah the son of Jehoiada, The Kethorites and the Peltharites went down and put Solomon on King David's mule and escorted him to Gihon. Zadok the priest took the horn of oil from the sacred tent and anointed Solomon. Then they sounded the trumpet, and all the king's people shouted, "Long live King Solomon!" And all the people went up after him, playing flutes and rejoicing greatly, so that the ground shook with the sound. So now, the rightful king has been declared, and the people now know about it, and they are shouting with joy. Okay, verse 41 through 48. Adonijah and all the guests who were with him heard it as they were finishing their feast. On hearing the sound of the trumpet, Joab asked, "What's the meaning of all that noise in the city?" Even as he was speaking, Jonathan, son of Abiathar, the priest, arrived. Adonijah said, "Come in. A worthy man like you must be bringing good news." "Not at all," Jonathan answered. "Our Lord, King David, has made Solomon king. The king has sent with him Jodok the priest, Nathan the prophet, Benaniah, son of Jehoiada, the Kethorites and the Peltharites, and they have put him on the king's mule, and Zadok the priest and Nathan the prophet have anointed him king at Gihon. From there they have gone up cheering, and the city resounds with it. That's the noise you hear. Moreover, Solomon has taken his seat on the royal throne. Also, the royal officials have come to congratulate our Lord, King David, saying, 'May your God make Solomon's name more famous than yours, and his throne greater than yours.' And the king bowed and worshiped on his bed and said, 'Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, who has allowed my eyes to see a successor on my throne today.'" So the self-appointed king thought he had made it. He thought, "You know, I know I'm not supposed to do this. I know I'm not the rightful king, but I'm gonna do it anyway." And he had all his little peeps around, and they were like, "Yeah, go ahead, you can do it anyway. They'll believe us, let's just go for it." And they went for it. And they thought they had gotten away with it because they were celebrating and they were still thinking that he, the self-appointed king, was going to be king forever. And he thought he had gotten away with it. More to the story, verse 49 through 51. At this, Adonijah's guests rose in alarm and dispersed. But Adonijah, in fear of Solomon, went and took hold of the horns of the altar. Then Solomon was told, "Adonijah is afraid of King Solomon and clinging to the horns of the altar. He says, 'Let King Solomon swear to me this day that he will not put his servant to death with the sword.'" So, if you read on, which I'm going to stop here, but if you read on through chapter 2, it does not end well for King Adonijah. It does not end well for him. So, the moral of this story is that God will always have his way. And in the end, he wins. God wins. So sometimes the enemy thinks he got away with something and he knows it's wrong. His little peeps know it's wrong. Deep down in their heart, they know that it's wrong. Some of his peeps didn't know that it was wrong. They legitimately thought everything was okay. They didn't know. But the majority of them knew that it was wrong. And even when it appeared that that king had won, and he was king, God's like, "No, no, 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 that is not the king. I have my king picked out, and that's how it's going to be." So that is a conclusion to my little story today based on 1 Kings. And I just want to say that they lived happily ever after.